honor and pleasure of welcoming you here. Congratulations on finding the room. Congratulations on finding the session, and thank you for your patience throughout the day. I know it's been, I think this is the third time it's appeared in the schedule, so thank you for hanging in there with us. I'm so delighted to be here at the second Karachi Literature Festival. I had the great fortune to be here last year, and I'm thrilled to be back, and especially honored to have the chance to sit here and have the chance to discuss with Mohammed Hanif on my left. I wanted to just tell you a little bit about Hanif's varied and dynamic career, and then we will have a little discussion. I'm going to ask Hanif some questions, and then I hope that you will all, I know you are burning with questions to ask him as well. So start thinking about the questions that you want to ask, and we will turn it over to you. I wanted to tell you that Mohammed Hanif was born in Okara, Pakistan. After leaving the Pakistan Air Force Academy to pursue a career in journalism, he worked for Newsline and the Washington Post, and in 1996 moved to London to work for the BBC. He has written plays for the stage and screen, including a critically acclaimed BBC drama and the feature film The Long Night. Hanif is a graduate of University of East Anglia's creative writing program. His first book, A Case of Exploding Mangoes, was published in 2008. It was long-listed for the Man Booker Prize, short-listed for the Guardian First Book Award, won the Shakti Bhatt First Book Prize, and the Commonwealth Writers Prize for Best First Book. After 12 years in England, in 2008, he returned with his wife and son to live here in Karachi. Just last week, he finished a new novel, which I know we are all eager to read. As Julia Slavin wrote in the Washington Post, A Case of Exploding Mangoes, quote, belongs in a tradition that includes Catch-22, but it also calls to mind the biting comedy of Philip Roth, the magical realism of Salman Rushdie, and the feverish nightmares of Kafka. To his predecessors is like trying to compare apples to, well, mangoes. Because Hanif has his own story to tell, one that defies expectations at every turn. Now, I also want to say that while you're in the clapping mindset, that if you clap really, really, really hard, Mohammed Hanif may consent to read from some of his new work. It was pretty good. That was pretty good. But Karachi Literature Festival fans, I know you can do better. So clap your hands together one more time for Mohammed Hanif. So, thank you. Now, I'm going to begin just by asking you a couple of questions, and as I said, I hope that my audience members will step in. In 2009, A Case of Exploding Mangoes won the Commonwealth Writers' Prize, as we discussed, and readers like us often have a tendency to assume that all first novels are the stuff of autobiography. In this case, you were writing from the perspective of your character, Ali Shigri, a student in Pakistan's Air Force Academy, an institution that you attended. But your book is not an autobiography. Now, I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about how you mined the archive of your own memory to create the world of an Air Force cadet, and what role did your life as a journalist play a part in the development of the novel? You describe writing this book as an act of, quote, frustrated journalist's revenge.
Yeah, it was. I mean, it is true. It was a frustrated journalist revenge. I mean, as a journalist, we kind of sometimes try to do stories which we know that we can't do because we don't have the information, and people who are supposed to have the information, they either they don't have it, they don't want to give it to you, and it's concealed in kind of, you know, sort of there are layers after layers after layers of, like, lies that you're told. And that's what I came up against. I tried to interview some of these old generals and some of these State Department types who happened to be around here in Pakistan in 1988. And it was very clear to me, like, you know, sort of within a few weeks, that there is no way in hell that I'm ever going to find out that how this plane went down. So I think that's when I sort of decided that if you can't find out the truth, then you sort of make it up, which is what other people have done here. And there's a strange kind of taste to this book, because I've been meeting sometimes you run into somebody important, like a former general or somebody. And this has happened to me. And first I found it amusing, and then I found it scary that somebody will put their arm around your shoulder, take you into a corner, and say, "What a brilliant book. Beta, who told you this?" And you're like, "My God, these people who are running my country." And I got a letter last year, like in the mail, somebody found my address, my BBC address. It was from a mid-level serving army officer. And the character, main character in my book, Ali Shigri, he has a sort of house up in the mountains. Like, and I come from Okada, which is as plain as anything can be. So it was basically a fantasy type house that I... And this guy wrote me a long, elaborate letter where he used to visit our house. He used to go on shikar and drink with my older brothers. And my older brother is a Haji Saab, like never done shikar, never. And there's nobody kind of who's remotely kind of even has a name which even rhymes with Shigri. But this guy had written me like a 3 pages long, earnest letter where he'd kind of, spend lovely holidays in our house. So I don't know, sometimes you kind of lose this this kind of, what's fact and what's fiction. In fact, somebody sent me a novel from Lahore, like a young journalist. And I was just, and then he called me up like, a day later, as young earnest writers do, that what do you think of it? And I said, "I haven't read it yet, but I will read it and get back to you." He said, "You will like it." I said, "Look, sort of give me a chance to make up my mind." He said, "No, because you will like it, it's the truth." I said, "Look, it's a novel, why is it the truth?" And then I asked him, "What does he do?" And he's a sub-editor in, one of our big Urdu papers. So I said, "You kind of print lies in your newspaper and you write the truth in your novel. That's slightly fucked up." But I don't know, he just, I hope he wasn't offended. But he did say that I don't own the newspaper, so I just work here. So it's like, I just do what they tell me to do.
It's so interesting. I mean, thinking about the intermingling of fact and fiction and this kind of the dual inheritance, if you will, of those missions. And I wonder, I mean, you're an eminent journalist in addition to a novelist, and I wanted to ask you a little bit about some of your recent experiences. You were in Ramallah when protests in Egypt erupted last week, mm-hmm. and you asked people around you to put what was happening in Egypt into context. And mm-hmm. it's a fascinating thing that you happened to be in Palestine at that time. And you asked them whether something like this could happen in Palestine. You wrote, quote, "It was the obvious tourist question, but they were generous, as they had been asking the same question of each other." Later, they ask you if similar protests might take place in Pakistan. And I wonder if you could tell us what it felt like to be in Palestine at this historic moment, and perhaps what we can learn here from what is happening across the Arab world.
Well, I mean, as I'm no expert, I was there like for 10 days, and I was teaching children in Barzit University, which is one of the oldest universities just outside Ramallah. And I was staying in Ramallah, which as some of you probably know, is the posh bit of Palestine. Like the real misery kind of happens in Gaza. The kids used to joke like when this million march was happening in Egypt, and they would ask each other, "So what's happening in Gaza?" So like, million men starve. So Palestine is, it's like a part of humanity, but basically living in a cage. And I'm sure there are people who've described it much, much better. But it is like, you basically lose your humanity. It's like, you want to see what it's like to live, surrounded by these so-called human beings and to be treated like an animal day after day after day. And the scariest thing that I found was that all Israeli officials army, police, immigration officials, they're all kids. They're all 18 years old, boys and girls. And you kind of sometimes want to go up to them and slap them. No, just like you sometimes want to slap teenagers because they're just being irritating or you don't like their face. And they scare the hell out of you because they've got these guns that you've only seen, like, you know, sort of in really hardcore action movies. Like, you don't even kind of, you know, see them anywhere else. So it's a scary, but they're very, very courageous lot. Like, you know, sort of, we were taken off this bus, which happens to everyone every day. And you would think that by now, this has happened for so long, that these people would be covering. No, I saw these old men, kind of, you know, sort of 75 year old and kind of, you know, just giving hell to kind of, you know, this Israeli kid in his own language, jise hum Urdu mein kehte hain, maa behan ki, you know, sort of in front of the whole bus. So they don't take it lying down. They kind of, you know, and they, for some strange reason, they kind of love to party. I mean, Ramallah is full of like cafes that stay open till 5 a.m. in the morning. And I was joking with this Palestinian businessman. I said, it just seems that the only reason you guys wanted freedom was so that you can have a cafe society of your own, which is what they seem to do. But the funniest thing I went through Jordan and the Jordanian immigration. I think I kind of realized that Jordanian Israelis, they probably go to the same school because their line of questioning were kind of similar. And this Jordanian brother kept insisting, he couldn't get this in his head. He kept saying, you're a Muslim and you don't speak Arabic. I tried like all my inshallah, mashallah, kalma, but he couldn't, it was just unfathomable to him. So he was obviously, you know, para likha, had been to university. But it was like, you know, if you're a Muslim, you don't speak Arabic. How? So he was very confused about this, right?
What did it feel like to you, I mean, in the 10 days that you were there, to being a Pakistani in Palestine? How did people interact with you when you...
People were a bit mildly curious that what is a Pakistani doing here? Because in Ramallah, you get lots of NGO workers from the West, like, you know, from Europe and America. There are lots of kind of, you know, good-hearted kids who come there and kind of, you know, do their... try and help out people and kids, and you know, so there are all kinds of NGOs there. So, but they don't really see anybody from Pakistan very often. So they're mildly surprised, and then some kids actually complain to me, and these are obviously well-off kids who get to travel outside of Palestine, and they told me recently, you know, what has started happening? That these people, we go to America, we land at an airport, we tell them who you are, say Palestinian, and they mistake us for Pakistanis and treat us badly. And I thought, like, it can't get any worse than being a Palestinian. But these kids were serious. I mean,
Your course in Palestine was called Writing from Life. And I wondered, what kinds of, you know, if you imagine that we're your students, what kinds of lessons were you imparting to these young Palestinian kids or college-age kids about writing from life? Again, I'm thinking about sort of this mingling of fact and fiction and documenting contemporary reality that you've done so brilliantly.
I mean, this was my first attempt at teaching. I've never taught before. So basically, I just asked around, like, friends. I have friends who kind of teach creative writing regularly. So they'd given me some exercises, and then I did the thing that everybody does. I Googled how to teach creative writing. And I got some exercises. And but they were all girls for some strange reason. There were no boys. So only, it seems, girls kind of want to write. Boys are kind of busy doing other stuff. So I basically kind of, I asked them to kind of write their kind of real stories, and then kind of, you know, sort of embellish them a bit. And then one thing that I wanted to try, I was a bit reluctant, but I did try. There was a very famous Pakistani film called Zarqa. You guys remember it was set in Palestine, and it has a very famous, lovely song by Habib Jalib. It's called Raks Zanjeer Pehen Kar Bhi Kya Jata Hai. So I was running out of ideas, so I showed them this song. And I didn't tell them anything. I said, you know, sort of watch this song, and then take on whichever character you want to take on, and then write from that character's perspective that what's going on. And my God, it was a riot. because they wrote such funny, hilarious things that we just couldn't stop laughing like for half an hour. Somebody became like an Israeli general who's hungry and wanted to go home. And like somebody like took on like, you know, this guy, Ijaz, who's singing, like, you know, he's constantly concerned about his body, like, you know, sort of look at my muscles.
So there's something about a Pakistani film song that freed their creative muse.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I think Lollywood worked finally for somebody.
You've been active not just outside of Pakistan in encouraging new writing and emerging writers, young writers, but also within Pakistan. And you've recently been involved in bringing Urdu fiction to new audiences in English. One thing that I read recently, you recently translated a piece of risque Urdu fiction for the new Life's Too Short Literary Review, the first edition of which I'm holding here. And the piece follows the adventures of Sabiha Bano, a wealthy Pakistani socialite who meets young women that she's interested in on public buses. And stories like this, the one about Bano, I understand, were silently collecting dust until Faiza Khan and Aisha Raja stumbled upon them and discovered that this story was part of several erotic Urdu fiction serials that had thrived in Pakistan in the 1970s. So I was wondering if you could talk about the process of translating this story. What intrigued you about translating it? Was this a genre of writing that you were aware of? Were you a follower of this at that time?
You want me to confess to reading lesbian erotica when I was young? Never. No,
are you interested in translation? Is that something that you've
done?
No,
I wasn't. Faiza said, can you contribute something? And I said, I actually don't really have anything. Maybe I can translate something. And then somehow, you know, sort of we stumbled upon this, and which I used to read when I was like, you know, sort of most boys my age. But, you know, the funny and strange and slightly sad thing is that this collection, for example, has like 8-10 brilliant short stories by new writers. And for some strange reason, everybody, the reviewers, people, kind of everybody talks about that bit of lesbian erotica. So I guess sex sells like 70s or 90s or like, you know, sort of even now. I don't really think it was erotica. It was detective fiction. You used to have like these digests in which, like, you know, sort of there was a in every episode, and these went on for years and years and years. So there's like an adventure, and every adventure, you know, sort of has to have a bit of you know, sort of sex in it. It just so happened that it was like, you know, sort of a woman who liked other women, but rest of the time, you know, sort of she was actually hunting down Arab sheikhs mostly, who were trying to kidnap Pakistani girls and kind of fighting with smugglers and kind of, you know, doing all kind of good stuff. But people just, you know, sort of.
Well, I mean, it's you're absolutely right. I mean, it's made it to the New York Times. I mean, people have been writing a lot about this issue in large part, I think, because of the translation that you did. And I would imagine not being able to read it in its original language, I don't know, but also it strikes me as it's a nuanced translation as well. I wondered if you could talk a little bit about the process. How do you translate? Do you go word
this
for
was
word?
This was my first attempt, and this was easy because, you know, sort of it's all about, you know what? But I've just translated another story by Ali Akbar Natik, who's a brilliant, brilliant Urdu writer, and that was a bit difficult. I've done like 4 or 5 drafts. Now it's done, but it is a lot of hard work, and and now I kind of begun to realize that why doesn't it happen? Because Pakistan has this major problem. That Sindhi literature doesn't get translated into sort of Urdu literature doesn't get translated into Sindhi, Punjabi literature, like even Punjabis don't know what's being written in Punjabi. So nobody knows like each other's stories, basically. And now I've kind of having translated this story, because it's a lot of hard work. It's a labor of love. Nobody kind of, you know, sort of really pays well for that kind of thing. So it just has to come through, like if you really, really love something, and you would want your friends or, you know, sort of other people who like reading but can't read in that language. So I think it only comes from that kind of, you know, sort of that you know, I really, really would like other people to share this experience that I've been through. Yeah.
And do you use the same part of the brain to write as you do to translate?
I don't know.
I mean, because it strikes me, it's a creative act, but it's in a different...
Yeah, it's a... I mean, you obviously kind of use more dictionaries, and you kind of, you know... and you have then friends, and you suddenly realize that actually you have friends who've translated, and they're kind of, you know, actually quite good at it, and they know tricks. So you kind of show them, like, you know, a draft, and then they would, you know, sort of make it better for you. But yeah, I think if it works out in the end, like, you know, if you sort of complete the translation, if it captures at least some of what the original, and then people read it, I think then it's a very satisfactory experience, as was this. Yeah.
Now, you write different things in different languages, I understand. Yes. And I was wondering, what language do you think in?
What language do you think in?
I think in English. But that's because I only really speak English.
I don't know. I mean, I think depends, like, you know, sort of when I'm sort of half awake in the morning, I probably think in Punjabi, and then, mm-hmm. then, you know, the day goes by, kind of a bit of Urdu, a bit of English, like, you know, sort of, I don't really know. I've never been able to figure that out. Like, people would sometimes have these theories that what language do you dream in? God knows, like, you know, sort of you dream in every kind of language. I was dreaming in Hebrew the other day, and I don't even know Hebrew. So these, these are mysteries. I've never been able to.
But no, so of the languages do you speak, you speak Urdu and Punjabi and English and
yeah, no, yeah.
And do you find, do each of those languages have certain properties that make them uniquely suited to different times of day or different
kinds of
description?
Yeah, when I want to kind of lecture people, for example, do a rant about, like, you know, how bad things are around us, then I think I gravitate towards Urdu because it kind of, you know, you can really do like a big khutbah in Urdu. And people, for some strange reason, kind of like it. And you like, you know, sort of being verbose and kind of, you know, using this and drawing on all these historical references, which are quite familiar to people. So yeah, that's when I tend to write towards Urdu. Drama, whenever I try to write, I think I try to write in Urdu or, like, you know, sort of whatever language it is that we speak, a mixture of Urdu, English, and Punjabi. So I think that's how.
And, well, much has been written about the distinctive satirical style of A Case of Exploding Mangoes. And you've said that growing up in a dictatorship leads naturally to humor. Mm-hmm. And I wondered if you could tell us about why you believe that is and how you believe your own sensibilities may have been formed by living through Zia's regime.
Yeah, I mean, people who watch Pakistani TV talk shows these days, I mean, they must have noticed that that almost every single channel has got now, like, you know, all these people, year after year, we used to condemn these people that Lahore mein jo theater hota hai, wo bahut fohsh hai. Wahan pe bahut fahashi hoti hai. That it is vulgar, that, you know, sort of all these comedians and cheap jokes and girls dance, and, you know, there used to be police raids, and, you know, every few months it will get banned. Now, all those people, the stars of that little kind of, you know, niche industry, they are on mainstream TV, like, you know, 8 p.m., like, you know, and they've been my favorites for, like, you know, 20 years. I think they're kind of, you know, some of the finest kind of commentators that this country has produced. And for some strange reason, this thing has flourished in Punjab, mostly. So I think because there has been that tradition that you stand on a street corner and you kind of, you know, make fun of, like, you know, Maulle ka Maulvi, your own dad, like, you know, sort of the Chaudhary Saab, the government, America, you know, whatever. And it used to be much more risky. People used to be able to kind of make fun of, like, you know, sort of of religious stuff and spiritual stuff and all that. That was like part of our kind of normal day-to-day on-street discourse. And some of it has now kind of, you know, gone mainstream, I think. And it's on TV. And I think it's great. I mean, good for them. Like, you know.
You said yesterday that you've always had a day job and you've always written in short bursts, and I was really intrigued by this. You said some bursts are as short as 10 minutes long.
Yeah, and I said that, I mean, that was my longest burst. 10 minutes. 10 minutes is very
that right?
long. Yeah, yeah, yeah. 10 minutes is very. No, when I'm rewriting, or then I can spend like half an hour on something. But when I'm writing, it's like mostly really short, kind of, you know, sort of one page a day is a brilliant, brilliant day for me. That doesn't happen like, you know, sort of very often.
But I was intrigued. You said that when you were working full time, that sometimes you would be taking notes during a meeting and structuring structuring chapters while you were sitting with people. Mm. Now that you're writing full time, how has that impacted your work schedule? Does that mean that you have, or how has your relationship to your writing process changed, if at all?
A, I still have a job. I'll never leave my job. B, I think it's made it more difficult. When you have a full-time job, then you know that from 9 to 5 or 10 to 6, you have like 1 hour lunch break, and then you have to be there, and then you have your weekends, or you could sneak in like an hour before your work starts, or like, you know, sometimes late night. So you know, like, that you have to steal time from somewhere, you know, sort of. That this is your day and this is like structured and you have to kind of steal something. Ek ghanta yahan se, aadha ghanta yahan se. But when you wake up, like, and your whole day is kind of stressed ahead of you and you have nothing to do except like, you know, drop your son to school, kind of, you know, talk to your wife or you know, sort of make breakfast or stuff like that, or watch TV. So there's like nothing. So you think that, oh, the whole day is ahead of me, I can just do it whenever I want to, and you don't really do anything, you know, because when you had that half an hour, you knew that that was the only time that you had, and you had to sit down and kind of try and be productive. But when you're kind of, you know, free, you know, sort of, then it becomes, I think, for people like me, I'm sure it works. I mean, I have friends who've never done a day's job. They're full-time writers, and that's all. That's all they do. Yeah.
So, do you find it helpful to impose a structure on your day? I mean, do you give yourself deadlines?
I think it is helpful. I think, yeah. When you kind of, you know, sort of know that you only have 2 hours in a day to indulge yourself in doing whatever you're doing, I think that's helpful.
Now, if you're writing, if you're happy with a page per day output, let's say arbitrarily. Mm. It strikes me that you'd have to have a tremendous confidence that you can stick with it, and then you're going to get through a long, you know, let's say 300-page book. You've got to really believe in the story that you're telling.
Yeah, and I'm kind of a one idea person. When I have like one idea in my head, then I can't work on anything else. Because I have friends who are working like simultaneously on 2 books, or a book and a play and a movie script, you know. I can't do that. If I'm working on a novel, then that's all I can do. I can't. And my kind of problem is that I know that till the time I don't finish that thing, I can't do anything else. So yes, I don't know. I would like to think that there is some kind of belief that you actually believe in right doing whatever you're doing, and you have that faith that it's going to be good. No, you have like, you know, your doubts every day. You think that, oh, this is like, you know, this doesn't make sense. Why did I write this? Or why did I, you know, how did this happen? But you kind of, you know, sort of muddle through, I think.
Well, you've said that finishing a book is akin to the feeling of being left by a dear friend or a lover who is never coming back. Mm. And that now that you've finished your second book, so recently you're going through a grieving process. Mm. And I'm wondering if you could tell us about your revision process. Is it as painful as your writing process?
No, I'm kind of more of a rewrite person. I mean, I love rewriting stuff and kind of fixing it and kind of. So I somehow, I don't find it that problematic as kind of actually, you know, sort of writing something for the first time. Because when something is on the page, then you can play with it, you know. So I do believe in kind of, you know, sort of going over and over and over. And somebody said something recently, kind of something very obvious, that every time you read something that you've written, and every time you go through it, chances are that you'll find at least 10 things in it that you can improve, and in my case, that's completely true. Yeah.
And is that true even of published work as well? Do you still have that relationship to?
I know I don't. I can't pay to read it. No, I don't. I mean, I do it like for readings. I'll have like one pet chapter that I'll read everywhere. But no, I don't. I think it's perfect when it's published. It's perfect. You can't do.
Well, I know I'm not the only one who's anxious to hear a little bit of some of your more recent work.
How much time do you have?
You have all the time that you want. We have 25 minutes.
Okay,
so,
cool.
But we can, if you want to read for a little bit, and then we'll open it up to questions. So.
Okay. God, this is going to be long. Okay, I'll start reading it and get bored. Yeah, I wrote this piece. Sometimes people ask, like, you know, where does the writing come from? Like, how do you write? Where do you get your idea? And sometimes it's as simple as somebody asking you, can you please write something for us? Like an editor or like, you know, sort of, and then you say, what? And they say, like, you know, you're the writer, you think of something. So this particular piece, my friend Niza here, she was curating this exhibition, she was doing a catalog, and she said, can you please write something? I said, I know nothing about art. He said, just write, you know, something. So I just thought about it. I've lived in Karachi for a very long time, and when I was sort of single and before I got married, I moved around quite a bit. Like almost every year, I will be find myself in a new place and in a new neighborhood. So I was getting nostalgic and kind of, you know, thinking about, like, you know, sort of those days. So I wrote like these little sketches of all the places that I've lived in Karachi before I got married. Yeah. And they have like little kind of headlines which are quite obvious to, will be quite obvious to anyone. And the first one is called Aage Samandar Hai. Your first home in Karachi is a little room in a big empty house near Sea View. The owners live in Norway, the servants live in the house, and you live in a little extension that was probably meant to accommodate those servants. You have one bag of clothes and books, a cassette player and three tapes. You drive a Suzuki 100 that you bought from a milkman. This is the first time in your life that you're living close to the beach. Judging by the stench in the evenings, it seems half of Karachi's population has pissed in the sea. At night, you wake up to the roar of the waves. For a moment, you are scared. Is this a giant bellowing? Is this a tornado approaching? Is this what grown-up life is like? A pair of Bengali servants, you'll never discover their exact relationship, take care of the house. To your lonely heart, it seems they've been hired to canoodle in every corner of the house. They seem so much in love with each other, it frightens you. You wonder if you should have rented the premises in Bloch Colony, where the owner promised that the water pump was situated only one street away and it would be okay if you wanted to keep goats. Your sustenance comes from a litter bottle of Fanta and a large fruit bun. You take a bite, you take a sip, you kickstart your bike and roar into the city. One day you pick up the bun and see fungus growing on it. You start spending your nights in Sabzi Mandi. So the next place is Sabzi Mandi. Sabzi Mandi ki sair. Without ever asking or telling, you move in with a friend who lives in a room in a private school right next to Sabzi Mandi. The school has rented room to its new arrival in town, who is a reformed druggie, a recovering socialist, and struggling theater artist. You wake up to the cackle of 1,000 children in white shirts. It's a bit like living in the middle of a poultry farm. You can't really get out of your room till the kids go home, but after school and on the weekends, you're king of the establishment. The basketball hoops are yours, and so is the headmaster's office. You do the rounds of Sabzi Mandi at night, not really looking for vegetables. People come from all over Pakistan, and you get to sample the diverse gifts they bring and share generously. Your new friends in the neighborhood are embarking on their political careers. One stops by to ask if he can borrow a churidar pajama, as he has to report for duty at 9:00. People's Party boys tell you that the only way to get the People's Party leader to accept their demands is to wield a US flag and a matchbox, preferably when cameras are around. Which hasn't changed still, I think. After school hours, the school sometimes turns into a gambling den, a drug lab, and a rendezvous point for friends of friends for a bit of random love. You come back from work and count 5 used condoms strewn around the place. You feel melancholic. A friend arrives from one of the backward districts of Punjab and brings with him a stereo so huge that all of you can't fit in the same room. Empress Market ke Badshah. You think you are on the top of the world because you find a flat on the top floor of an 8-story building that overlooks Karachi Grammar School. You hire a maid who some days has to make 25 chapatis because it seems all the drifters from the Punjab's backwaters have congregated here. Sometimes there is nothing to go with the chapatis except yogurt. You go to work where your office tea boy is a 55-year-old who lives with 18 cats in a tiny shack. He used to be a butcher once. He shows you his sliced thumb to prove it. He would like to get back to his old profession. One evening, a dreaded gentleman from your past barges in with a woman with large eyes and a chadar. His claim to fame is that he has slept with 263 women. He keeps a diary. He has shown you the diary. You are rude to him and make sure that the woman doesn't become 264th in your flat. You like being the moral police. You come back very late from work one night, and Empress Market Square is resounding with the beat of drums and dozens of Pathans in a circle doing their dance. You've seen that Kathak dance on TV. The circle parts for you and you join in. They all think you're queer. Meanwhile, your tentative housemate's tentative girlfriend threatens to throw herself out of the window. The place is clearly way above your budget. Kashmir Road ke mehman. It's called Azadi ya Maut. You live as a paying guest at a famous poet's rambling mansion on Kashmir Road. Your head spins as you enter your room. The room is circular. The bathroom looks like an igloo from the outside. Your life turns into a bizarre set of events. You adopt a street puppy who is kidnapped. You rescue it and then abandon it. You start meeting boys from Nata Khan Goat who run a theater group. It seems the goat is populated by theater enthusiasts. They are so smart that they can look at your ashtray and tell your future. They tell your future belongs in Nata Khan Goat. Okay, it kind of goes on and on. And there's like something we do, Nautanki in Nata Khan Goat, and then we have Sea Breeze, and then you move into a studio. And the last bit I will read, which is, and then you live in a dead poet's house and learn to read. The life lesson that you will learn in this damp Zamsama apartment, you will learn from a prostitute. But before that, you discover a world of wonder. Your new flat was owned by a poet who died young. The place has nothing but books, many times thumbed books read with love, passages underlined, reactions noted, little slips of paper with cross references inserted, obscure words circled and explained. Here, your housemates are Borges, Calvino, and Muhammad Khalid Akhtar. You have always read books, but you have never really learned to read like this. Here, each book you pick up comes with the gentle guidance of your late landlord, Saghir Malal. He tutors you from beyond. He teaches you the bleeding obvious. You can't write if you don't really know how to read. Then one day, your occasional housemate goes out and comes rushing back with two women. Outside, there is a curfew, and the women need shelter for a while. They have come all the way from Kurangi 6 to meet some clients who seem to have disappeared. One is a tall, dark Amazonian character with wild laughter and wants you to write her tragic love story. She comes from a backward district of Punjab. The other one is short and confident and wants to make a few phone calls to try and make contact with other potential clients. Aren't you scared of roaming around in the middle of the curfew? So far away from home, I ask. The tall one thinks that not only do you have no money, you are also stupid, and replies in her backward district's mother tongue. It's work. You get screwed. You get paid. What's there to be scared of? Thank you.
Thank you so much for reading. So in our remaining time, I've been instructed to go till 5:15, just so everyone knows what we're doing. I'd love to open up the discussion to the audience. So I think hopefully we have a microphone floating around, and I see a hand going up over here. The gentleman in the white.
Thank you. For the brilliant piece of reading. I had a quick question. So a lot of your work, I mean, Exploding Mangoes was much earlier, but I recently read Button Bhatti. It reads really spontaneously, that entire description of, you know, from the gunshot till the end. Do you also write it that spontaneously? Is the thought process also that spontaneous?
No. I wish. No. That's like what you probably see is the 20th draft or something. Yeah. I wish. It kind of goes through lots of kind of scribbles and lots of writing, overwriting. No. Sometimes, if you're really lucky, you might get a paragraph which kind of works like right from the word go, but a lot of it is just like, you know, sort of, yeah, absolutely a lot of work, yeah.
Thank you. Hanif Sahab, I, of course, read your case of exploding mangoes, which was, I told you in the lobby, was cathartic. I loved the General Sahab so much and enjoyed the multiple treatments that he received in the book. But also read your article, your abdication note in The Guardian about moving back to Pakistan. If just to remind you, you talk about the generator in the end. You say there's a power failure, etc., and everyone's saying, why are you going back? And that was 2 years ago, and that was inspirational. How do you feel now?
A bit tired, but otherwise okay. I mean, we're fine. We're kind of, you know, we complained all the time, but we're probably some of the most privileged people in this country. Sometimes we should just shut up and get on with and try and do, like, you know, sort of what you do. Yeah.
In that same piece, I was interested that you wrote about your son's own conflict about leaving the UK and moving back to Karachi, and I wondered if you could tell us a little bit about how he feels about being from two places, or if he feels that he's from two places.
He loves it. I mean, he's he says that now. I've kind of, you know, jokingly asked him, would you like to go back and live in London? He says, no way, because, I mean, teenagers love a country which has no rules. That's what he says. Like, you know, why would I want to live in London? And his kind of, ideas are quite basic. Like, Pakistan is a place to live and London is a place to shop. Like, you know, sort of that's a, so he's learned it quite quickly, and he knows all the bad Maimon jokes, and, you know, sort of, so the kids kind of, you know,
Will there be a sequel to Exploding Mangoes? Zia may be dead, but Shigli is young. Yo, no?
In my desperate moments, I have thought about it, actually. No, I have, seriously, because I told myself exactly the same thing. How does the book end? Shigri actually walks away, doesn't he? So, yes. Yeah, that's my pension plan.
While reading Exploding Mangoes, a question which kept coming to mind, and I'm going to ask you this now, it was a bold writing in many ways. I was just wondering, did you ever get intimidated by the so-called establishment or the agencies, either then or afterwards?
No, I mean, no, not really. I was sent one message by General Ziaul Haq's son, Mr. Ejazul Haq. Some of you might have seen him on TV. So, which was, you know, sort of through a journalist, ke agar mere walid sahab zinda hote, to phir main dekhta ye novel kaise likhta ladka. Which I found, like, you know, sort of, yeah, you're absolutely right. I couldn't have.
We have a question in the front row.
Hello?
And I'll repeat the question after you.
No, they hadn't. Because
did everyone hear that?
It's very difficult to find books in, kind of, you know, in that place, like, you know, sort of. So, but they've asked for it, and I've promised that, you know, sort of, I'll get them some copies. They hadn't read my book. Yeah.
And we have a question in the towards the back.
What advice would you give to young aspiring writers to get it more exposed and to share their stories to the whole world?
Sorry?
What advice would you give to young writers that want to get more exposed or to share their stories?
I think they should read. I keep meeting lots of kids who want to write, but they don't really read. They don't really want to read. And that's that can't really work. I mean, if you don't like books, you can't really be a writer. It's like, you know, sort of saying that, you know, sort of, I hate flying, but I want to be a pilot, or something like that. Something as absurd as that. So sometimes people don't see this most obvious link, that if you don't really like books, and if you don't think about them, and if you, you know, sort of don't really care about good writing, then, you know, it's not likely that you will write. Yeah, so I think reading, and reading well, is the, I think, the first step.
You've lived and worked a considerable time of your life in both countries, but your writing is mainly composed of this region. Mm. Have you ever thought of going transfrontier and writing something about UK from your point of view, which we might benefit?
Not yet, but at some point, maybe, yeah. I mean, I've thought about it, but I don't really have a compelling story that I want to tell, but at some point I might.
You spoke about learning from a poet across the grave from his books.
Yes.
Could you share a story, something from one of those books, one of those connections that really changed you, moved you?
No, it's very rare. I don't know people who kind of rent apartments and then you suddenly rent a place and you've already lived in 6-7 places and you just walk into a place and this poet has just died and this flat has all his books and his family is not interested in books. His family is not interested in books, and they're saying, like, you know, just do something with these books, like, you know, keep them. And then you start reading them, and you read writers that you never read before. Borges, I didn't even know who Borges was. So I pick up a book because I like the cover. It is like brilliant, like, you know, sort of from 40s or somewhere. And then you open it, and you say, my God, who's this guy? I want to kind of, you know, sort of read more and more and more of this. And then he had, late Saeed Malal, he had this lovely habit that, you know, sort of sometimes we read, and English not being our first language, sometimes there are these obscure words or Spanish words that writers use. And we kind of sometimes, we're lazy, we won't have the dictionary, but he'd kind of underline them and kind of write the meaning in the margin. So that kind of, you know, is a big help for somebody lazy like me, you know, sort of.
I have a question, which is there anything you can tell us about your forthcoming novel as you head into the revision process?
Yeah, I think it's called, I can tell you the title, and then, you know, sort of, it's called Our Lady of Alice Bhatti, and it's a love story, you know. There's also a marriage in it. So
a marriage.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you. There's a question here.
Yeah, actually I was prompting my younger two niece and daughter to ask this because they stayed back for your session. Can you reminisce a little bit more? Last year you spoke more on your first supremely brilliant and popular novel, a little bit more on that process, number one, and has it been taken for translation at all or anywhere?
Yeah, it's been translated in some bizarre places, Bosnian and Serbian, and it's been translated into, yeah, quite, I think, 19 languages. And a friend of mine is trying to translate, a friend has promised to translate it into Urdu, and another one is doing a Sindhi translation. Which is great. I mean, it's like one of those sort of silly joys of life to see your book in a language that you can't read. It's like, you know, so it has been translated.
And I think the audience member was asking if you could talk a little bit about the process of your first book. So I'll just ask you, you have written about how a punishment you received at the Air Force Academy led to your being confined indoors, and you discovered the school library, which turned out to be a fortuitous punishment, as we can see. Your book's been compared to the legendary thriller Catch-22, among other novels. And I wondered if you were conscious of this influence or of the genre of the spy thriller. Was that something you were aware of?
I was like, Catch-22 was like my bedside reading for, I don't know, 10 years. I must have read it 22 times, yeah. Yeah, I used to be able to quote like passages from it. It was like one of those kind of, you know, written for you type books. You are in Air Force and somebody's written a crazy book, craziest book ever written about the Air Force. And the guy used to be in the Air Force. And I remember this remarkable quote from him, because people, his later novels are not as famous. And somebody asked him, like, why haven't you written another Catch-22? And he said, who has? So I think reviewers are either desperate or generous when they make these comparisons. But yeah, it's I mean, I'm sort of flattered, like, you know, sort of that. But yeah, it must have. If you read something so many times, remember it, I'm sure it kind of, you know, sort of seeps into whatever you're trying to do. Yeah.
Were there any other books or cultural influences that you drew on when you were writing Mangoes?
Yeah, I was just talking to a young man who was doing his PhD in on Tablighi Jamaat, and I just remembered that when I was in the Air Force, as a punishment, I was packed off to go and attend the Tablighi Jamaat session for something that I had done. So, and I'm sure that must have influenced me in some way. I don't know how, but it's...
Other questions?
What is your second novel about, the one that you just mentioned?
It's a love story. It's about a marriage gone bad kind of story, yeah.
But Alice
Bhatti, there has to be more religion. Religion, you mean? There's like some in the background, but not really. I mean, it's no, yeah.
So we have about 5 minutes left, so let's take, yeah?
Is this working, yeah? So your new book, Our Lady Alice Bhatti, your short story, as you mentioned, Button Bhatti.
Yeah, that was an excerpt from that.
Okay.
Yeah, that was an excerpt from.
Let's get the microphone over
here. Anif, have you ever written, or do you think you'll ever write in Urdu also?
No, I write in Urdu constantly. I do lots of journalism in Urdu. I have kind of written.
In terms of novel or short story?
No, I've written plays in Urdu. I wrote a movie in Urdu. Which Hassan Zaidi made, but no short story or novel I haven't written in Urdu.
I mean, just connected to that, I don't know what you think. You know, generally, a great novel, a good novel, sort of provides almost a unifying experience to a society. Do you think in Pakistan, English literature and what's being written in Urdu, you know, totally different sort of. People in different type.
Yeah, and similarly, what's being written in Sindhi is you know, sort of, you don't know, and we sort of don't even know if there are any writers in Balochi or not, right? I mean, so yes, there are lots of disconnects, and writing in English kind of, you know, can probably provide some entertainment / catharsis to. People who, like, you know, sort of can read in English. And then I think similarly with other languages, it's very, as I said, it's very kind of, you know, sort of island type kind of, you know, situations.
Let's take a couple more questions. And someone we haven't heard from, are you standing up in the stripes? If you could, have you already asked?
I'll wait.
Okay. Yeah, could you pass the microphone back, please?
Hi, Mr. Hanif. I also came from military background, grew up in the same GI years, and your novel, Exploding Mangoes, really hit me very hard. I wanted to ask you, what were your motivations? Were you writing because you had a great story to tell, simply a great story?
Or no,
You wanted to be a prime mover for some kind of a change. That's my question number one. And if this being so, then where's your next novel? Because if we were fighting against tyranny of 80s, of dictatorships in those days, I think now, more than ever, we need something even more resounding coming from you.
I don't know what my motivation was. I think I wanted to write. Yeah, that was my first motivation. And I didn't have a story, and this happened to be the only story that I had and I could tell. And I had obsessed about it for a while as a journalist as well, so it was there. I don't really believe that novels, especially written in English for, like, you know, sort of a niche, rich, middle class, upper middle class audience, like, you know, sort of change anything. I don't know. I think the best they can probably give you a few laughs or some cheap thrills, or kind of, you know, occasionally turn you on. I don't think they kind of bring any change as such. I mean, I hope not. Like, not my novel, no. And the second novel is, again, I'm trying to tell a story which kind of, you know, because again, I want to tell a story, and this was the only story that I had that I could tell. Now, you know, sort of, I will move on. Can I take 2 minutes to just tell a little anecdote? I was going to tell Huma, But I'll just, since all of you are here, so I'll share it with you. I wrote about it years and years and years ago, but maybe you guys read or didn't read. Huma has just done a story about these Jews who used to live in Karachi. It's in one of the magazines today. And I was just telling her that she should have talked to me, because I actually met some of those Jews who used to live in Karachi and then moved to Israel in the 60s. As I was like about 10 years ago, I was, as a BBC reporter, I was covering like, you know, sort of this, and somebody told me there's a little town in Israel, it's called Ramleh, which is full of these Indian Jews. So I thought, brilliant, I must go and, you know, sort of meet up with these guys. So there was this little synagogue, they were having like Hanukkah type thing going on. So they said, just come there and everybody will be there and you can meet them. So they spoke, like most of them were from Bombay, and they kind of, you know, spoke Hindi, so I could talk to them. And then for some strange reason, you know, sort of like these things that Indians do, that, oh, this guy has come from London, please, like, you know, now address us, give us a little speech. And I didn't really have anything to say. I just told them about myself, that I am from Karachi, but now these days I live in London. As soon as I mentioned the word Karachi, somebody started to cry in the back, like, you know, and I was like, what the hell is going on? And then I, after that thing speech ended, I went and talked to this guy, and he kind of, you know, hugged me, and he told me that he was like, as a kid, he grew up in Karachi, and he used to live here, and, you know, sort of, he was calling his synagogue as our masjid, ki hamari masjid wahan pe hoti thi, aur wo Ayub Khan to itna acha hota tha, ab phir koi aa gaya hai, musharraf hai. They had like, you know, very little idea that what was going on. And he was like, you know, sort of just remembering, ki acha, wo abhi tak hai, wo cinema hai, wo cheez hai, wo ye hai. And then I started asking him what his life was like there in Ramleh. So he kind of took me in a corner. He said, ke, you know, yahan pe sirf hum do ghar hain Pakistaniyon ke, ye baki sare India se aaye hue hain, aur aapko to pata hai ye Hindu hame kabhi manenge nahi. I was like, yes. So we kind of suddenly, in the middle of the state of Israel, we started bonding as Pakistanis. I was like, yes, that's, I know.
Okay. And on that note, please join me in welcoming and thanking
Hanif.
I'd like to ask Martin Fryer of the British Council, Mr. Martin Fryer of the British Council, to present the gifts to the author and the moderator.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.